much. Color is generally three-dimensional. If you want to describe, if you want to have a model that shows every color that you can see, however you look at it, it's a three-dimensional model. For example, this is RGB. So in the corner that in towards us, you see white. That's 100% of red, green, and blue. If you go to the bottom right-hand corner, that's 100% of blue, but no green and no red. So this cube represents, in a sense, all the colors that we can see, but it's three-dimensional. This is another way of explaining it. This is or looking at the colors. Hue, saturation, lightness. There are many ways of describing color. This is the Munsell color system. Again, it's all three-dimensional. It's difficult to handle three-dimensional models because you can't draw it on it, you can't project it, and you can't draw on it. So it's good to have two dimensions. What we need is a two-dimensional picture. So what we can do is to get rid of one of the axes, if you like. And the axis that you can, in this case, in the case of the 1931 CIE diagram, we get rid of is the lightness. So what we see is everything is the same lightness, but the hue changes. So that's good enough. So you can imagine this is every color, except it can get darker and brighter. So what you see there is every color that the eye can distinguish represented somehow on this diagram. The spectral colors, the pure laser colors or pure wavelengths, they go from the bottom, from 400 nanometers that you can see at the bottom, all the way around the sort of on the left up and then down again to 700. That's the way it's. We won't go into how this was this came about, but that's it. It's generally better to use what's the 31 diagram is now what 8 years out of date. 76 diagram is only 35 years out of date, but that's the latest one. So it's generally better to use this. It gives a better representation of the how the eye distinguishes between different colors. So in this diagram, basically in this diagram, if you mix, it's geometric. So if you have three colors represented by this triangle, anything that's within the triangle, any colors within the triangle, can be recreated by mixing those colors in the right proportion. You can use more colors, you can have four or five, then you get a polygon, but generally, we'll just deal with triangles here. So what I want to show it next few minutes is, firstly, it is not necessary to cover the large area of this CIE diagram. It's generally a lot of papers people try and get right to the edges, and it's assumed that we have to cover as much as possible because every color, we want to show every color. I'll then show you why it's actually, there are reasons not to cover the full area. Then I will show you or argue that choosing the right wings of holography has absolutely nothing to do with holography. It's color science. And the problem was solved in 1971 by a guy called William Thornton at Westinghouse Labs. So there's the triangle, every color that the eye can distinguish. And say we take three wavelengths from the argon and the helium neon 633. We draw the triangle, you can see that it's only covering, it looks like half of that, the patch. So it doesn't look good because we can't recreate all these colors which are below 476. Yeah? So people have been trying to get as big as possible, bigger triangle or polygon. However, let's look at what the colors are. The thing to remember is these colors, all the colors you see, these aren't colors that occur in nature. These are colors that the eye can see. A lot of them can only be created by mixing pure colors. So colors of, say, this piece of wood or a red flower or the bluest thing that you find in nature actually they are quite close to the center of this diagram. So what you can see is the green foliage, Caucasian skin, blue sky. These have been plotted. B, G, Y, R, these are the colors from the Macbeth color checker chart, which is a standard for colorimetry. They're quite saturated, but again, these fall right within the triangle, so we don't have to try further. And in fact, people have looked at all the colors. There's a guy called Wintringham, and then there was followed by Poynter. They took everything that they could find in the, including the reddest plastics and the deepest colors, and they measured the color plotted. And actually, this sort of irregular patch you can see, nothing exists that's beyond these colors. So everything is there anyway. We really don't have to try to make this triangle much bigger. So you might say, well, come on, all right, well, let's choose a big triangle anyway, because then we are safe. Well, here's the reason why not. Luminous efficiency. The eye is visible. The eye is not visible. The eye is sensitive to colors from around 400 to 700 nanometers. It's infrared and ultraviolet outside of those ranges. The sensitivity is not the same. It becomes more sensitive around, say, 550 and less around 700. So for the same amount of energy, a wavelength of 500 nanometers looks much brighter than, say, 700 nanometers. Okay. So what I've done now is let's take that chart we saw and let's plot that luminous efficiency along the curve, right? So what you can see at 450, let's say 1 watt of energy will give you only it won't look that bright. 540 will look brighter, and then it goes down again. So if you have a triangle, supposing you find wavelengths right at the corners, in fact, in the deep blue and deep red, the eye becomes so insensitive that you won't see them anyway. So it's not as easy as saying, let's get the biggest triangle. So really, I think that the CIE chart is not that useful in choosing the wavelengths for holography. Let's look at how we see color. So let's forget that for a moment. When we look at an object, there has to be light, there has to be an object, and there has to be an eye. So we're illuminating the object, and we look at the light that's reflected. The light has something called the spectral power distribution. So each wavelength has a certain amount of energy. The object has reflectivity from 400 to 700 nanometers. So the light is reflecting, and at each wavelength in the spectrum, you get another curve. That's what you see. And somehow, never mind, it's very complex, but the eye and brain will say this is a certain color. So the important thing is you are looking at the full, in that middle spectrum, that's the reflectivity. You're testing that spectrum from 400 to 700. Okay. Now, when we come to holography, using, say, let's say three wavelengths. What's happening is you are only testing that spectrum in the middle, you see. You've got 3 points within this whole spectrum. And what you are hoping is that that light, the amount of reflectivity, automatically mixes such that you still see a lemon as yellow and a lime as lime and an orange as orange. It seems a very difficult task because you've only got, of all that data, you've only got that 3 bits of data, that's all. So the problem is that if you switch the lights out, have 3 lasers falling on some objects, can you find 3 wavelengths that show you the object just as if in real life? it's a quite a complex problem. Color science is very complex, at least for me. I've been to color conferences. I've tried to work out. It's one of those things if you read about color for say a month, you think you know everything. Another 2 months, you think you know. 10, 20 years, you really haven't scratched the surface. So it is a very complex. It's psychology, it's chemistry, it's biology, and it's physics. So let's see if someone else has looked at this problem from the illumination point of view. As I say, William Thornton in 71, nothing to do with holography, he simply wanted to say, right, what is the best combination of wavelengths in a white light source for everyday use, supermarket, home, without looking at whether it was discrete or continuous. He looked at the CR, the color rendering index. Color rendering index is a measure of how good a color source is, how close to a standard white it shows you. And he didn't mind if it was discrete, if it was 3, 4 wavelengths, 10 wavelengths. Anyway, he did a full analysis, and he found that actually there are 3 wavelengths, that 3 parts of the spectrum which are far more important than other parts. And that was 450, 540, and 610. He called these the prime wavelengths. And actually, there are wavelengths in between they reduce the color rendering index. So if you have these 3 wavelengths and you add 480, it in fact, for whatever reason, which is not important here, but something to do with the dyes in the eye, it actually makes the color rendering index worse. So what he found was the best light for even every day, for reading, for whatever, to get the best colors were these 3 colors, nothing else. So we are very lucky, I feel, that we've these 3 colors. So these are the 3 colors I've put on the chart, 455. Again, it looks like it's a tiny portion of the triangle, but you see that bit in the middle, that's where all the colors are. There aren't any other colors. And if you're very unlikely to have colors right on that edge, and if you do, yes, they're missing the triangle, but they'll be just a little bit less saturated anyway, so it doesn't matter. So, yeah, I feel that these 3 wavelengths, which I looked at a long, long time ago, and I've looked at again, I think that's the answer. I think there's no, really, we don't have to look any further. We should find lasers, 3 lasers, as close as we can to these 3, and make color holograms. Thank you.
Thank you for the very interesting approach to this. And you are, of course, completely right that this has nothing to do with holography. But we have, of course, to consider our wavelengths are extremely narrow band compared to Thornton, because he was thinking of more broadband mixing. And as Percy and Hesselink have shown, that there are combinations of these 3 fundamental colors that for a given object or 2 given objects give exactly the same response in reflectivity. For example, a completely gray object or color object. So there is an undersampling when you only have 3 very narrow band wavelengths. I just check here with our findings, and it's very interesting that the computer program also came up more or less with this. It was 610, 545, and 466 in our computer simulation. So Thornton is correct, but the question is 3 may not be sufficient if you want to reproduce an oil painting, for example. Anyhow, that was my comment.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for this talk, it's wonderful. Can you give me an explanation? You mean that the printing industry, which start now to go from C3 to C4, 5, to make art print or something, goes the wrong way, that it's getting more dull in the color? How you apply it to the printing industry?
Well, printing is completely different in that it's subtractive. So they are completely different. We are talking about additive color. So subtractive color is a completely different game.
Just as a curiosity, this article came out in Discover magazine this month. Were trichromats having three cones, but about 12% of the female population has four cones, and they live among us and don't know that they're seeing more than us. We're seeing about 100 million colors, and they're seeing 100 million colors.
And they know they're seeing more than us.
They're lucky.
I just said they know they're seeing more than us. This is a little far afield, but have you discovered, as part of this research, any evolutionary reasons why our sensitivity is for those different wavelengths?
I haven't. As I said, color science is extremely complex. People are looking at different parts. I've scratched the surface. I have talked to people. I've gone to conferences and talked to people. I don't know is the answer. There are people are talking about why. They're still debating after all these years. They're still debating why these prime colors are better. For me, doesn't matter. All I know is that it's empirical results, and these are the only wavelengths we need.
On some high-end modern televisions, they've thrown in a fourth color, a yellow, to increase the vibrance of that particular band. How does that work with the Thornton numbers?
I don't know is the answer. The thing is, I don't know. That's the honest answer, and honesty always wins. Yeah.